It's an interesting question, because I had an unusual scientific trajectory in the sense that I didn't work with a senior person ever in my life, except once in the 1970s, a senior colleague, we wrote a paper together. But when I was a graduate student, I didn't write anything with my supervisor. He was very helpful to me, but we never wrote anything together. So I'm sort of self-constructed. However, there are a few people that I enormously admire. And of course, the usual people we all admire, like Einstein and Newton and Dirac and so on. Dirac comes from my city, Bristol. I often walk past the house where he was born. But no, people who have specifically inspired me. There's an applied mathematician called Joe Keller, who's now 90-something, still very active. He's in Stanford. I admire him. I admired him for many decades, but I only met him some decades after I encountered his work. And then there's some Irish physicists, Stokes, George Stokes, G.C. Stokes, influenced me. And in fact, this dates from a visit to India many years ago, 1988, the centenary celebration of C.V. Raman, name you know, of course. And a number of people didn't arrive at this meeting in Bangalore, and I was asked to give more lectures. So I gave a number of lectures about different aspects of my research, and suddenly, in the middle of one of them, I realized that every single lecture I was speaking about was based on some idea that went back to Stokes. So I found out much about him, and I admire him very much. His style was very different from mine, but he's somebody I admire. I wouldn't call him a role model. And then J.L. Singh, who's an Irish relativist, who had a wonderful clarity in his writings, and who I met when I was a graduate student indeed. And almost by chance, what he had to say influenced the whole direction of my future research. So there are such people, and in my own department there was a tradition of geometrical thinking, not as mathematical as me, but still geometrical and pictorial thinking, which I absorbed after a few years in Bristol, and that has affected me. And some of those people, in particular the way in which some of them have avoided bureaucracy in their lives and organizing things, which I've also avoided, have been as close as you could think to role models, but none of them is exactly a role model. I'm sort of largely self-constructed, but I've been influenced in a number of ways. As a child, I was fascinated by astronomy, and I think, I know, that a great many physicists and mathematicians started out by being fascinated by astronomy as children. It's interesting. You can speculate why. It isn't really clear to me. We live in a world where children, as I was, listen to the news, or they hear it, they see the newspapers. There's a lot of trouble in the world, and it's somehow comforting to look at these realms very far from all of our troubles. Of course, I now know that the universe is an extremely violent place, and our Earth is a fairly peaceful little enclave. But still, that's just a guess as to why astronomy is so attractive, a world that's beautiful and away from our human troubles. But anyway, I went to university and realized that, you know, astronomy is based on physics, and physics has beautiful ideas in it, which then superseded the astronomy. I still liked astronomy as a member of the public, you know, but it isn't the center of my research. Many years ago, I gave a series of lectures in Chicago. And my host was a very distinguished statistical physicist, Leo Kadanoff. He's a very famous physicist. And after the lectures that I gave on subjects very different from his, he said, "It's very interesting for our students to hear you to hear somebody who has such a well-articulated research plan. And I said to him, Leo, you are mistaken. Often when I go to work in the morning, I have no idea what I'm going to think about that day. So it might appear to you as though I have a work plan, but often I don't. However, if I'm intensely involved in a problem, this occupies me continuously. So wherever I am, when I'm at home and I'm half asleep, or whether I'm at work by my office, I'm thinking all the time about this problem and technicalities. Usually mistaken thoughts. I mean, most physics you do is wrong, but you know, one makes some progress. And so I don't really have a plan as such. I actually don't. Yeah. I'm an organized person, you know, things like the limited work I have to do of a bureaucratic kind, like booking air tickets. I'm flying different almost every week to another country, booking air tickets and arranging hotels. I do very efficiently, but that's not what I would call my working day. I mean, I do that to leave myself space, and I try to reply almost instantly to emails, and just to get them out of the way. Some people leave them for weeks and weeks, but I can't do that because they worry me all the time. I think I should be replying, so I do it, and then I get on with thinking about physics or mathematics or whatever. Cook. I like walking, and you know, I occasionally go to the cinema. I read a great deal. All kinds of books, philosophy, novels, you know, history. I'm reading now a book about Newton's studies of the chronology of events in human civilization based on the Bible. He spent more time in his life on this, which we now think is a kind of nonsense, actually, than he did on the physics, for which we admire him. It's fascinating. That's what I'm reading, one of the things I'm reading now, also a novel that my son gave me. So I read a lot, and I like cooking, you know, that's what I do, walking when I can. I don't get much chance, but there's a lot of nice countryside where I live, and when I visit places, not so hot as India, that I like to walk. I mean, I cook food from all countries. I love to make Indian food, actually, and also Brazilian food, many different things. But my favorite activity is to come home. My wife and I, we don't quarrel about much, but we vie on who is going to do the cooking. We both like it. But my favorite is to go at home, look inside the fridge, see what is there, some leftovers and this and that, and make something which will never be repeated. Okay. So it's the opposite of having a recipe, you know. So, yeah. But I do occasionally like to follow recipes, yeah, but no one in particular. I don't like musicals, but almost I've recently seen the movie about Stephen Hawking. I saw it on the plane coming here. And there's one about Alan Turing,
yes,
which both of them I liked. So these are two recent movies that I've seen.
Jazz.
Oh yes, I mean, different musicians who reach deep into the heart in different ways. I dream of doing a piece of theoretical physics which has the same immediacy and beauty as one note from Louis Armstrong's trumpet. But there's a saxophone player called Sonny Rollins who's been playing for almost 70 years, and I have 30 or 40 of his CDs, and this music strikes very deep into me, the sound, the quality of the sound he makes, and his particular approach to melody and improvisation. And of course the famous people, Duke Ellington, and you know, so I like the great people over the whole range of this type of music. much, but there are some very good musicians who aren't so old, and I occasionally hear them. I don't know the latest of them, but of course now it's possible, with the improvements of technique that people make, for people to copy and sound like these musicians from older times. And, you know, it's fun to listen to them, but of course this is not the original, and copying, even if you do it perfectly, is not the same as creating. You know, there are people who are much more mathematically adept than Schrödinger was when he wrote his wave equation, but he's the great man and the others are not, because he created the thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh yes, no, that's the standard procedure in jazz, is that there are certain melodies which are like Summertime, I wouldn't call them covered, they're played and sung by a variety of musicians, each of whom has its own way of interpreting, and I love that. I mean, they're called standards. Yes. Yeah, this I like, yes. There's another thing, there's something about jazz which is, one day I'll write about this in more detail, which is a bit like theoretical physics. The improvisation of a group of jazz musicians, the way they bounce ideas off each other and exchange and suddenly and improvise and then they repeat something, is not unlike the kind of conversations between theoretical physicists. When you park your car, reversing into a small space, you sometimes find that you've not been very efficient and you find you're some distance from the curb. You then discover that by reversing and forward, it takes a very large number of maneuvers to get close to the curb when you do this parking. And there's a reason for this, because what is driving? You have two things to do, you drive and you steer. Now those two activities don't commute with each other. If they did, you could do all the steering in your garage before you left home. Of course you can't, they don't go. Now, what is this parking? You make a series of periodic maneuvers, you make a cyclic series of changes, and after each cycle, the car has shifted. Now this idea, which is a geometrical idea, that you can change something cyclically and something else shifts, so it doesn't come back the same as before. This is a branch of geometry called parallel transport, and the geometric phase is an application of this idea to the oscillations you get in waves. So in a wave, something is vibrating all the time. Okay. If you slowly change the conditions under which the wave is traveling or evolving in such a way that you come back to the same conditions as you started, that's the cycle. And you ask, what is the state of oscillation of the wave, it's called the phase, then the answer is, it's not what you thought it was. It's not the sum of all the little individual oscillations. There's an extra part to do with the geometry. I call it a kind of quantum memory. You see, the ordinary oscillation, which takes place even if you don't change anything, it's there all the time, after some time answers the question, how long did your trip take? The geometric phase partially answers the question, where have you been? Okay, so that's what I would say. I would use this analogy with car parking. That's a good question. I mean, I'm not so interested in that, actually. I'm very happy when people say that they are applying it. I mean, there is something called adiabatic quantum computing, and the dream is that this type of phase might lie at the basis of techniques for making a quantum computer which diminishes the vulnerability to external noise. The big problem with quantum computing is that it's a very delicate, coherent thing, and while a computation is going on, you mustn't look. And indeed, any influence from outside produces what's called decoherence. It washes out the delicate interference that enables in theory, quantum computers could be so efficient. And the idea is, if you base a quantum computer on something geometrical, that's less vulnerable to influences from outside than the techniques that people use at present. Well, there's a large activity called adiabatic quantum computing based on the geometric phase. Mostly it's theory, and there are a few little test experiments, but as you know, a quantum computer doesn't exist yet, so it's at least one that has any serious usefulness. So there's that. And in optics, there's various kinds of optical switches based on polarization that have been proposed, and they work. Now, how practical they are compared with other switches, I'm not sure. So there are many applications within science and in condensed matter physics. The whole subject of topological insulators, quantum Hall effect, and aspects of graphene. The geometric phase is central to all of those, but that's within science. I think you meant an application in the lives of people who are not scientists, if you meant that. But within science, there are many. In 1995 or 6, I can't remember, I was visiting Zurich with a friend who said there is a very interesting toy shop in Zurich, a scientific toy shop. It has the name AHA! Exclamation mark. Right. Well, this toy shop in a little street called Spiegelgasse is immediately below the apartment where Lenin lived when he was planning the revolution. And it's just up the street from the cafe where he used to sit, where the cafe owner made the famous statement, "Those guys will never make a revolution, they're only talking." Right. That place. Anyway, I went to this one, and there was the Levitron. Now, the Levitron, you know what it is. It's a scientific toy where you have a magnet inside a solid wooden base or plastic, and a spinning top which is magnetized, which you spin and suspends above it. You know, and I was immediately fascinated by this toy, and I made some comments. I was thinking all the time about it. This looks like the kind of a macroscopic analog of the kind of traps in which people, scientists, hold microscopic particles. You know, it looks, how does it work? I don't know. And the shop assistant was, I would just say, stupid. She said, "Oh, we're not interested in these details. We try to understand the universe as a whole." Okay. Idiotic. The American expression is airhead. Okay, but still, I said, I'll buy it. "Oh, you can't buy it. It's the only one we have." Okay, so I couldn't. But then somebody bought me one, and I spent a long time understanding how it worked. Now, of course, it was invented. Now, it was invented by people who had patent applications, which I read, and they did not understand the physics at all. There's a fundamental theorem which, if it applied rigorously, would have told any physicist that it was impossible to levitate a magnet above another. Well, there's a little loophole, which I discovered, and how it works. But it's very delicate. There's a tiny region of stability, and you have to make sure that the magnetic field balances gravity, so you have equilibrium in this narrow region where you have stable equilibrium. It's a geometrical thing, it involves the fourth derivative of the magnetic field. It's a technical calculation, which I was very happy with, and I published it. And for a time I was giving lectures. This Levitron is quite tricky to operate because of this delicacy. Indeed, since magnetism of a lump of metal depends on temperature. If you raise high enough, you get the Curie temperature, it disappears. The height at which the top is held in equilibrium depends on the temperature, and you have to change little weights on the to make sure that you stay in that stable zone. So it's actually quite delicate, and most of the time you fail. I became very good at it, because if you give lectures, then you must be you must make sure that you can achieve it in a lecture theatre with people. So I managed to do it. Actually, I'll tell you a funny story. I was in Bangalore and I was invited to give a lecture, and my son suggested I should give the title Levitation Without Meditation. So I gave this title, and then my host called me and said, look, I'm a bit worried by your title because it might attract the wrong kind of person. Can you supply an abstract technically enough to repel such people? Well, I did it. And then on the day of the lecture, the email came out advertising my lecture, Levitation Without Mediation.
Okay.
I was so angry and I called her. I said, look, you've ruined the title. Please send an email which will create it. Otherwise, I'm not giving the lecture. Anyway, I gave it. So I was giving this lecture in a few places. It was popular. People liked to hear it. It was a good story. So, but one place I went to, there was a specialist on magnetism. He said, do you know that there's a guy in the Netherlands who's levitated a frog? And I said, no, it sounds like nonsense. You know, he talked about it. I said, it's completely different. But then I looked up what the guy had done. He hadn't published it. It was on the website. It was the early days of the internet. And then I realized that it's sort of the same, because it works because a frog is water. I mean, it's basically water. And water is diamagnetic. And diamagnetism results from little circulating electrons, which is like a spinning top. So the theory is not exactly almost the same. But this guy, I went and met him. He had done this experiment. He had a huge, powerful magnet for experiments on condensed matter physics. And the unique feature of his magnet, 16 Teslas, which, by the way, used 6% of the electricity supply of the town where he was, so he was only allowed to use it at non-peak times when people weren't cooking their dinners and so on. So anyway, the unique feature was that it wasn't at low temperatures and it wasn't in a vacuum, it was in air. So he thought he'd try this idea of repelling, but he found it very difficult to tune the magnetic field and the position and so on, but he did it empirically. But I gave a theory which precisely, to a few millimeters, indicated exactly why he had to use the conditions that he had found empirically. So we wrote a paper together. I did the theory, it was his experiment. Then, after some time, he called me and said, I've been invited to accept the Ig Nobel Prize. Should I accept it? And I wrote to him and said, look, it's a kind of fun thing in America. Some people don't like it. They think they're making fun of science, but they're not, actually. So if you find yourself in Harvard when they have this rather stupid ceremony, I don't see any reason why you shouldn't accept it. But what he did is he telephoned the guy, Mark Abrahams, and said, I will accept it, but only if you give it to Berry as well, because we did this together. He did the theory. So that's how I came to be involved. And I didn't go to the ceremony because I had a conference commitment somewhere else at the time. But anyway, it's a rather kind of silly thing. That's the story of the frog. It's essentially the same as the Levitron, not exactly. And I did the theory, and André Geim, who later went on to get the real Nobel Prize for graphene, different thing, he did the experiment. Yeah. No, not really. You know, let me tell you, my brother is religious. I'm Jewish, I'm not religious at all. My brother is a rabbi, he's a minister of religion. He thinks I am religious, but simply not in the usual way, because he thinks that what I do amounts to a kind of worship of the universe and its deep structure. Well, he can make that definition if he wants, and we're very good friends, although he knows I will never be converted. I'm a lost cause for him. But what I don't agree with is any of the organized worship and the rituals and the sacred books. But I want to say something. It's very important to say this. There are people, my brother being one of them, with whom I deeply disagree on these kinds of matters. However, I also am aware that there are many people with whom I disagree with, who I respect enormously as human beings. Really do, and I number them among my friends, not just my brother. On the other hand, there are people with whom I agree and who I dislike so much that I wish I didn't agree with them. So it's much more complicated. It's not a simple thing at all. But if you ask me a straightforward question in the usual way of a believer in one of the many religions, the answer is no. Now, let me tell you, we have in England a famous atheist called Richard Dawkins, and he was talking to a priest, and the priest said, "Do you believe in God?" He said, "No," and he said, "Actually, nor do you." And the priest, "What do you mean? Of course I do." So he said, "Do you believe in Ra, the sun god?" "No." "Do you believe in Thor?" "No." "Do you believe in Vishnu?" "No." "There are about 6,000 different gods that believe in. You believe in only one of them, so you're almost the same as me." It's just a fun response. I know that in Hinduism you have many gods. I think that's a very healthy thing. Hindu seems to be, apart from some of its nasty politics, it seems a very tolerant religion. I can understand that, sympathise with that very much.
Yeah, there is even a branch of Hinduism that's completely atheistic.
Yeah. Yes, I know. It's there are many different branches within. Yes. Both. You know, I was speaking here in this room this morning, and a very important concept is this: chance favors the prepared mind. So sometimes it can seem that some chance remark that somebody makes, you know, the geometric phase, I discovered it after somebody during a lecture asked a particular question, not before it, and I thought about this question, and I realized there was something deep there, and it took several weeks, and I found the phase. Now, I might have found it otherwise because I had all the ingredients in my mind, but it didn't happen that way. It happened almost by chance, but as I say, the prepared mind. On the other hand, sometimes you can really say, "I want to work this damn thing out," and you work and you work and you work, and then you do, or you don't. But if you do, that's the organized problem solving. And I do both. Both happen. It's a good question. I think that certain fashionable topics are very interesting and worth studying. Topological insulators, graphene, string theory, examples. My own taste is not to work on those things. I never advise other people to do it or not to do it. But as I again said this morning, I'm not a very competitive person. I also wouldn't like to have to every day look at the archive and see what people are publishing on this. It's good physics, it's very important. I also said, I have to repeat it, I was in Korea last year being interviewed by a newspaper, and the first question they asked was, "When will there be the first Nobel Prize in physics for a Korean scientist?" And I said, "Never, if all you do is work on fashionable subjects, because although it's good science, it's developing ideas which originated elsewhere, and they'll get the prizes if there are any." So that's my comment. I think that these fashionable, I don't work on quantum information, but I think it's a wonderful subject. And when students say, you know, who are not my students, but they you know, what is it I work on? I always say quantum information. The physics of entanglement is something where we know really rather little. We know even the Hilbert space of three particles has not been properly explored. It's fantastically rich subject of possibilities, which will change civilization in the way that Maxwell's equations change civilization, and ordinary quantum mechanics with the transistor and the laser change civilization. Leon Lederman, Nobel Prize winning experimental high energy physicist, estimated that about a third of the gross national product of the industrialized world is a direct consequence of quantum mechanics. You know, so, and that's the quantum mechanics without the modern entanglement. So this will have a, you can't predict how it will happen. At the moment, there's something a bit disappointing, which I tell sometimes my colleagues in quantum information. We've had 25 years or 30 years of quantum information, wonderful, deeper and deeper understanding, but many still unsolved problems. But the only practical application is to cryptography. Now, it's worthwhile. I don't want people to be able to get into my bank account, whatever. But keeping of secrets is not really a positive human thing. I would have hoped that there would be some more positive application of that. There will be. I'm sure there will be. It will happen. But so far, this keeping of secrets is a kind of miserable thing. You know, you have to keep some military secrets or, your, like I said, your bank account. But most things, you know, I was reading a newspaper article by a famous British writer called Howard Jacobson, and it was something, title was something like The Curse of Passwords, and I really agree. He said, I had received an email inviting me to a literary festival, and they said, we'd be very honored to have you speak at our festival. To discover the time and place where we'd like you to speak, please log into our website, create an account with a password, and then you'll find a message, you'll see the program. So he wrote to them and said, why don't you just tell me you would like me to speak at this time in this place? And they, oh, it's too complicated, we've got so many speakers. So he said, I never replied, I'm not going to such a place. Well, very often, you know, if I send a paper to a journal, if I'm asked to referee a paper, they say, oh, you've got to log into our website. And I say to them, of course, when you referee a paper, you don't publicize your report. You're discreet, but it's not like a national emergency. It's not so important if somebody discovers what you write, so I'm not going to do it. Just send me the paper and I'll return with the... So, you know, I don't think that this vast technology of keeping secrets and passwords and the quantum version of it is so important. I mean, it's not a positive human thing, which I would like to see. You know, I would like to see some analog of application of quantum information, which is positive, like the compact disc player or the GPS, which changed people's lives in a good way. You know, or some of the medical applications. Look, PET scan, positron emission tomography, based on the annihilation of positrons in your brain. This is quantum mechanics and relativity, really helping people, you know, but so far not. Well, it's a very good question. I mean, I wouldn't say that Einstein changed the conventional way of thinking. He changed the previous way of thinking. Of course, it's never been true that members of the public understand Newtonian mechanics, certainly not of rotating bodies. That's still very complicated. It's a subtle thing. So he changed the paradigm. But he did that by creating, the quantum mechanics people as well, did that by creating a theory based on experiment, which involved radically different concepts. Now, the problem at the moment is that quantum mechanics is too damn good. There are no experiments that contradict it. One day there will be. I'm sure it's not the last word. And then, in order to accommodate new discoveries, there will be some, it will take some time, some theoretical framework, which is radically different from which quantum mechanics would emerge in the same way that classical physics emerges from quantum in a way that's not straightforward, but it does, when you can neglect Planck's constant. So, but you can't predict how it will happen. See, quantum mechanics was invented in response to experimental observations on the spectra of atoms and molecules, which just could not be explained in the old classical way. But we don't have that at the moment. We don't have such experiments. So people do grope around and people try to find theories underlying quantum mechanics, but none of them is very plausible because there's no evidence for it. Look, we're a young species. We've only been around for, you know, a few thousand years as a civilization, a few hundred years doing the kind of science we do now. The difference from earlier ideas being the science we do now is communal. We talk to each other, and even though we're proud of our individual achievements, we learn from each other. So it's more like a group mind, which is more powerful than one person, and that's why science advances so fast. But still, we're a limited species. You know, there could well be aspects of the universe too subtle for us at our present stage of evolution ever to grasp. You know, whether we can go seriously beyond quantum mechanics, I don't know. It depends on observation and experiment. You really can't, as someone says, you can predict, prediction is very easy, except about the future. If there's an alternative theory that predicts a particular thing different from quantum mechanics, which is then found, great. You know, but there's nothing so far. It's up to people who do it. You know, some people have different motivations. You know, there are many reasons. You know, some people do science to become famous and meet women or men. You know, sometimes people do it to earn a lot of money. But most scientists don't do that. They do it because the thrill of discovery is so wonderful that you know, everything else is insignificant. So mostly we don't do it for the money. But I can't say what you should do. I mean, there could be plenty of scientists who do it for money and fame who do very good science. So people's private motives can vary a lot. But really, it's as Feynman said, it's the pleasure of finding things out, to quote him. And by the way, just to say, I'm still astonished that for my whole career, and I'm now officially retired, people actually paid me money, a salary, to have such fun. You know, I'm very grateful to be in a society civilized enough to be able to do that. You know. Yeah. It's actually, I think, very important. There's a sudden improvement in the quality of these programs now. In particular, in Britain, we have a guy called Brian Cox, and he isn't like Michio Kaku, who stresses the frontiers of physics and the possible futuristic notions. He talks about quite mundane things, the classical physics, but in a way that's very, very charismatic and powerful. And it's probably him who has had an influence in enormously increasing the number of students doing physics in the UK. There was a time, like in most places in the world, physics wasn't the most popular subject. It went down, people were doing media studies, this and that. That's different now. Our department is bursting at the seams. We have more good applicants than we can accept, you know. So this has all happened largely now. I suspect that a large part of that is due to these TV programs, which present science in a way much better than they used to. They used to be purely sensational and kind of personalistic, and they're much better now. Yeah. I had lots of interesting experiences in India. You know, the most beautiful day of tourism I have ever spent many years ago was on the backwaters in Kerala on the boat from Alleppey to Kottayam. One of many. Look, there are so many. I mean, I'm visiting many countries. I said I'm traveling almost every week to a different country. I was in Brazil last week. I came back and spent one day in Germany. Now I'm here. Next week I'll be in the USA. The week after that I'll be in Israel. And every country has its interesting attractions, and India is particularly rich. I love the food, you know, and people I meet I enjoy. I haven't had any real contact with the bad aspects, which of course there are, as in every country. So I don't want to single out a particular experience, because I think the whole place is wonderful. I want to see the snake park here in Madras, because many years ago I visited it. I wanted to see if snakes really move in the way that De Gennes got his Nobel Prize for polymers, which is to move parallel to themselves. It's a non-holonomic constraint in a one-dimensional field theory. Well, I did visit the snake park many decades ago, so they do this. Now I have a snake at home. My son had a pet snake, which somehow, after 20 years, the thing won't die. It started like this, now it's like that. And he's gone away. His girlfriend won't allow him to have it in their place. So now I see it. But still, I remember that snake park as a wonderful place. So I will probably either to there or the crocodile and snake park close by. You know, but these are just little things. I like just the street. Look at the streets in India. India is a fractal country. Every street is a kind of microcosm of the whole. You know, you can see everything there. You know, people buying and selling all kinds of things. Cows across the streets. Holy men walking up the street in front of all the lorries and trucks. I love it. And there's noise. I was in Calcutta once. I had to call my secretary in the street, and I said, before we talk, listen to Calcutta. I held the phone up, and she said, "It sounds very noisy." I said, "Yes, it is." I want to visit this. This Crocodile Park, which is close by to here, I'm saying. But then there's some temples in a place called Kanchipuram that I might visit, although somebody says they don't allow foreigners anymore in there, but I will see the places from the outside. This is an unpleasant development, by the way. I know there's a lot of discussion about it, but so I might go there. Also, just for the fun of being driven, I rent a car and I drive through the countryside in India, seeing all the little villages and stopping somewhere and having a lunch in some little place with banana leaves, you know, and I like this. Yeah. So that's what I'll probably do here. There's also a government museum, which I'm told has beautiful things. I'm told that, like the government museum in Calcutta, it's in a disgraceful state of neglect and disrepair, but nevertheless has wonderful things in it. So that's, I will probably see that too. That's enough. The weekend will be gone by then.
But mainly you'll be around Chennai only.
Oh yeah. No, I don't have time to visit other places. Yeah. No. Sometimes I do, but I've visited many different parts of India over the years, but this time not. I'm going home on Monday morning. Have fun.
Okay. So, yeah, on that note, we'll end this. Thank you very much.
Thank you. It's my pleasure. Good. Who knows what that will look like, but never mind. I don't think I said anything bad, did I? No.